Yes, ma'am. And we can see you. Yes, ma'am.
Is it okay now?
Yes, ma'am. Absolutely fine. Ma'am, should we start?
Yes.
Sure. Okay. A very good afternoon to one and all present here. Institute Innovation and Entrepreneurship Cell of Geetharatan International Business School feels immensely delighted to welcome you all on this virtual session of National Education Policy and its impact on technical institutions. I, Dr. Rashneet Kaur, take this opportunity to welcome you all on behalf of Geetharatan International Business School. This session is organized to understand the details of new education policy, and the speaker for today is Dr. Veena Bhalla. Geetharatan International Business School was established in the year 2004. It is affiliated to Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Delhi, and approved by All India Council for Technical Education, Ministry of HRD, and Government of India for Technical Courses and Bar Council of India for the Law Courses. The Institute conducts various courses, namely MBA, MBA International Business, BBA, BBLLB, and BALLB. The Institute is accredited as Category A by National Assessment and Accreditation Council and assessed as Category A plus by State Fee Regulatory Committee and rated highest grading A by Joint Inspection Committee of Government of NCT of Delhi and DGSIP University. The Institute has been rated grade A by Academic Audit Cell of DGSIP University consecutively for past 7 years. GIBS has also been rated number 2 twice consecutively by Times B School Survey 2018 and 19. New education policy has the potential of changing the entire education paradigm in India. It is the progressive step undertaken by the Government of India. However, the implementation of it would require guidance. In its perpetual pursuit to deliver existential learning and offer global exposure, GIBS is very delighted to organize this virtual session on national education policy, and to discuss the topic we have with us Dr. Veena Bhalla. Dr. Veena Bhalla, PhD retired as Joint Secretary, Student Information Services and International Division in Association of Indian Universities. Her continued research interest has contributed papers on examination reforms, distance education, and international education. She has published 35 papers, and also co-authored 5 books, and has assisted in editing 6 books. The books, monographs co-authored by her include International Students in Indian Universities, 1997, Foreign Providers of Higher Education, Realities, Implication and Future Options, Internationalization of Higher Education in India, Annual Survey of International Students of India 2013-14. The book edited by her include Handbook of National Education Policy 2020. Dr. Bhalla has been the member of International Advisory Group of Project Atlas of International Institute of Education, USA. We welcome you, ma'am. We are honored to have you here with us today. Now, without taking much of the time, I would request ma'am to take the session forward and illuminate us with her expertise. Ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, madam. Hello. Good afternoon to all, and I just want to discuss few things on new education policy 2020 for universities, a vision for excellence. Slide, please. Hello.
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Now I start from this quote. Educationists should build the capacities of the spirit of inquiry, creativity, entrepreneurial and moral leadership among students and become their role model. This is said by Dr. Maulana Abul Kalam Azad. I just wanted to tell this, and now we will start on this. First, the vision of India's new education system, National Education Policy 2020, envisions an India-centric education system that contributes directly to transforming our nation sustainably into an equitable and vibrant knowledge society by providing high quality education to all. The world is undergoing rapid change in the knowledge landscape, with various dramatic scientific and technological advances such as the rise of big data, machine learning, and artificial intelligence. Many unskilled jobs worldwide may be taken over by machines. The growing emergence of epidemics and pandemics will also call for collaborative research in infectious disease management and development of vaccine, and the resultant social issue heightens the need for multidisciplinary learning. Education is fundamental for achieving full human potential, developing an inadequate just society, promoting national development. This gap between learning system and reforms, the gap between the current state of learning outcomes and what is required, must be bridged through undertaking major reforms that bring the highest quality, equity, and integrity into the system, from early childhood care and education through higher education. The gap between the current state of learning outcomes and what is required must be bridged through undertaking major reforms that bring the highest quality, equity, and integrity into the system, from early childhood care and education through higher education. In more than seven decades since independence, the Indian higher education system has undergone a remarkable transformation from an elite system nurtured by colonial roots to a mass system attempting to meet the demands of vibrant democracy. There were only 20 universities in 1947, which were established in 1947, and two were established after independence. These were Punjab and Rajasthan. And before that, there were 18 universities only. The state of higher education was re-examined by the Education Commission of 1964 to 1966. I'm giving this introduction before this because we should know about all the commissions and committees before this new education policy 2020. So this is type of introduction and all that, and we will be, this will be useful for everyone to know this. This is called Kothari Commission, which is which in its report emphasized the need for built-in flexibility in system of education for the necessity for education to be science-based and coherence with Indian culture and values. It visualized education as an instrument for the major for the nation's progress, security, and welfare. It advocated for research reforms. Based on Kothari Commission report, National Policy on Education 1968 was adopted. Now, I would like to tell you this also, that this is called Radhakrishnan Committee, and in its report, Government of India, which came in 1950, stressed amongst other things that Indian education must be rooted in its cultural heritage. It gives guidelines for the structuring of higher education and recommended that University Grants Commission Committee should recognize and should have the powers to allocate grants within local limits set up by the government. An interim University Grants Commission was set up in 1953 and given autonomous statutory status by the Act of Parliament in 1956. The state of higher education was re-examined by the Education Commission and after this, it visualized education as an instrument for the nation's progress, security, and welfare. It advocated far-reaching reforms. Based upon the Kothari Commission report, after National Education Policy 1968 was adopted, nearly 20 years later, the National Policy on Education 1986 aims at not only developing manpower for serving the economy, but also developing crucial values. National Education Policy. Universalization of education from preschool to secondary level with 100% GER in school education by 2030. GER in higher education to be raised by 50% by 2035. 3.5 crore seats to be added in higher education. National Education Policy 2020 will bring 2 crores out of school children back into the mainstream. New 5+3+3+4 school curriculum with 12 years of schooling and 3 years of Anganwadi or preschooling, we can call it. No rigid separation between academic stream, extracurricular vocational streams in schools. Vocational education to start from class 6 with internship. Teaching up to at least grade 5 to be a mother tongue or regional languages. Now I'll tell you a little bit about the progress of universities and colleges. As started earlier in 73 years since India gained independence, a higher education system has shown remarkable growth. It may be noted that since independence, the number of university level institutions has increased from 18 to 1,091, and out of which 418 are state universities, 125 are deemed universities, private universities are 370, central universities are 54, and 124 are institutions of national importance. And number of colleges are also increased from 591 in 1947 to 43,000. Number of students from 55 lakhs to 4.5 crores. Number of teachers from approximately 24,000 to 15 lakhs. Universalization of education from preschool is secondary level with 100% GER in school education by 2030. Now it is 24% gross enrollment ratio, and it will be 100% in 2030 if we adopt fully this new education policy. Gross enrollment ratio in higher education to be raised by 50% by 2035, as I said, and 3.4 crore seats to be added in higher education. NEP will bring 2 crore out of school children back into the mainstream. New 5+3+3+4 school curriculum with 12 years of schooling and 3 years of Anganwadi, as I said earlier also. In view of the requirements of 21st century, the aim of a quality university of college or college education must be to develop good, well-rounded and creative individuals. It must prepare students for more meaningful and satisfying lives and work roles and enable economic independence. Quality university and college education must therefore aim to be both a joy and an opportunity to which all citizens must have access if they so desires. Now, major reforms I will tell about higher education. 50% gross enrollment ratio by 2030%, as I said earlier, and holistic and multidisciplinary education, flexibility of subjects, multiple entry and exit will be there. UG program will be three or four years. Like if we complete 1 year in UG program, one will get certificate. If 2 years, then they will get diploma. If it is they complete 3 years in UG program, they will get degree, and or for 4 years they will get honors degree. Like this in PG program also, it is 1 or 2 years. And integrated year bachelor degree or master's degree will also be introduced now. And MPhil has been discontinued. And Credit Transfer Act and Academic Bank of Credits will be there now. Higher education institutions like research in intensive, teaching intensive universities and autonomous degree granting colleges will also be there. So about credit transfer and bank detail, tomorrow Mrs. Mamta will tell you in detail these things. Now, as per new education policy, all the universities will get academic, administrative and financial autonomy also. And phasing out affiliation system in 15 years, National Mission on Mentoring, Independence Board of Governors, single regulator for higher education, excluding legal and medical. Online self-disclosure based transparent system of approval in place of inspections. Common norms for public and private higher education institutions. For private philanthropic partnership, free fixation within broad regulatory framework. Public investment in public sector to reach 6% of GDP at the earliest. Now, issues affecting quality of higher education. While the Indian higher education system is one of the largest in the world, the quality of universities and colleges and the education they offer is far from satisfactory. The number of institutions of high quality is limited. Even topmost Indian institutions do not figure in the international ranking of universities in the world. This is an issue of major concern and the subject of frequent public disclosures in India. The quality and standard of Indian higher education institutions need to be upgraded systematically and sustained at a high level through rigorous screening, innovation and research, recognition of excellence and creativity. Currently, there is no regular system of regular monitoring of educational outcomes. There is a large network of research institutions providing course of advanced learning and research leading up to PhD in branches of science, technology, agriculture, social science, languages, and other disciplines. Many of these institutions come under the umbrella of Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, which is CSIR, and Indian Council of Agricultural Research, ICAR. The Indian Institutes of Technology, Indian Institutes of Management, Indian Institute of Science, the National Institute of National Institutes of Technology, and the Indian Institute of Information Technology, and among the most prestigious institutions in the field of science, technology and management. Now, the number of these, you know, high quality, as I told you, are limited. Even topmost Indian institutions do not figure in the international ranking of the university in the world. First is variation in quality. At present, there is wide variation in the quality of higher education institutions in India. Some institutions like IITs, NITs, IITs, IIMs have been globally acclaimed for their higher quality of education. Alumni from these institutions have made impressive contribution in science, technology, research, management, business, and commerce, both in India and abroad. However, barring a few, India still lacks universities and institutions that could be considered to be at par with best universities in the world. Teacher availability. With the rapid increase in the number of higher education institutions, the availability of quality teachers have emerged as a major constraint. Appointment of vice chancellors. A vice chancellor as the academic and administrative head of the university plays a definite role in promoting institutional leadership and academic excellence. So we should appoint a vice chancellor which is having very good vision and which will take the university in the heights of the world actually, and ensuring quality in higher education. Policy interventions gave generally tended to focus on the gross enrollment ratio in higher education, which is currently around 23 and sought to be increased. Through the Rashtriya Uchchatar Shiksha Abhiyan, RUSA, to 30%. Now, objectives of national policy on education. The core of objective of this policy is to provide information, knowledge, skill and values, instill social attitudes which enable a student to become a good human being, a proud citizen, to contribute to the development of the country, harness of the full potential of the young vibrant population will equip to the contribute meaningfully to India's development. The core objective of this policy is to provide all these things, and through education, the policy tries to create an understanding of the need to promote social cohesion and national integration, which are essential for the country's progress. And at the end, again, I will tell you a quote of Dr. Maulana Abul Kalam Azad, that education imparted by heart can bring revolution in the society. Thank you very much. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Haji.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, we will be having certain questions.
Okay.
Right. So I would request all the participants to please, if you have any questions. Yes, ma'am. The first question is of R.K. Gupta. Do you think that only new educational policy will make Indian institutions to make them list in the world of, you know, world-class institutions? Do you think that this policy will actually make them one of the world-class institutions?
No, actually, we could have done this earlier also with the old system also. But in this system is very flexible, and we can say it is light and tight also. and many regulations they have introduced which will be of use and which will take the universities up to the level of world universities. Hopefully, this policy will be very good for that. Yes,
ma'am, there is one more question of sir. That new educational policy actually looks like an old wine in the new bottle. You know, rather than making any drastic changes towards the quality of education. Ma'am, what are your views?
I mean, it is always there. When we see the drawbacks which were not there in the old policy, we introduce in the next policy. Right of the beginning, we are doing this. There is a need of increasing the number of institutions. Now, slowly and steadily, after a few years of independence, this NAC was formed, and like that, NBA was, National Board of Examination, was also formed. So, we should always say old is gold. And that was the base, and every time we improve ourselves and we bring reforms in higher education, maybe this is definitely better.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. There is a question from Nitish Mahajan, sir, that what will be the change in overall job sector after the new education policy?
Actually, when students will do good, they will be placed well. As we heard, many students from IIT, almost all IIMs and NITs and triple ITs and all that, they get very good jobs. And if we improve our institutions and quality will be there, of course, placement will also be better. More options are available in this new education policy, and students can follow passion also, then only they will be able to get the good jobs. It depends on the teachers and students both.
Yes, ma'am, absolutely correctly said. And there is one more question, that how national education policy is going to affect higher education system in India? What changes and modulations do you think that it will bring in the higher education system?
Actually, right from the beginning in this policy, from class 6, they are going to tell about skill development. Internship will start from class 6, and after that in the college also, if one wants to study after in the college at UG level, as I told you, after 1 year, a student will get certificate. After 2 years, they will get diploma, 3 years degree, and like that. And they can, there is a very flexible, they can choose the subjects of their liking. And skill development, they can start from the beginning so that they will get the job also.
Yes, thank you so much, ma'am. Nishtha Bhardwaj, ma'am, wants to ask that how this new education policy will give, you know, or how this system is going to give new opportunities to the students, and when it is going, will be applying, actually be applied to the schools and colleges.
Academic session will be the same, but the examination system, they are going to change. Let us see how, and they are emphasizing on distance education and online education also in new education policy. So they will get very good number of opportunities to go, to enhance their education. So when they will, while doing the job, they can enhance the education and they will get increment, or they will get the better jobs than they are doing now. So all these things, it's very flexible. As I said, it's light and tight. Because we have to follow all the rules and regulations given by the government. As AICT has now said that without some engineering degrees will be awarded without having chemistry and physics or maths, like environmental education, agricultural education and all that. Some can go for B.Tech degree, or now they are introducing BE. Also for the engineering students. Yes, madam.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. Ma'am, there is one more question from Harpreet Bedi, that what do you think? Are the students being overburdened by this policy, or will the students be, able to adapt the policy quickly and happily?
They will not be overburdened. That's there. This is in the new education policy. It's very flexible, and there won't be any problem, and it will be opportunity to do better actually by adopting this policy.
Right, ma'am. Actually, there are more questions here. That there will be. What do you think, ma'am? Nitish Mahajan wants to ask that there will be more or less number of jobs as employers will demand more skills. But for the teachers, I think that he wants to say that will the number of jobs increase or decrease? Because the skills that are required will definitely increase.
नहीं, फॉर ऑल दीज थिंग्स ऑल्सो पर्सन आर रिक्वायर्ड एंड नंबर ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटीज फॉर जॉब्स विल बी इंक्रीज पॉजिटिवली.
Yes, ma'am. There is a point that R.K. Gupta also wanted to ask, that while educators would like students to learn for the pure pleasure of learning, the reality is that large number of students focus on education with the end point of getting a good paying job. Right? In order for this to happen smoothly, job opportunities during each of the exit points need to be planned well in advance. Right? So the students can have a focused approach and make decisions when they exit the college system. And he wants you to throw some light on this topic, like how would the system or the system plan in such a manner that, because the students are more interested only in the end of getting a good paid job. So how would you, yes.
नहीं, दिस इज वेरी गुड क्वेश्चन, बट इट विल बी बेटर व्हेन एवर दे थिंक ऑफ लीविंग द आई मीन स्टडी इन बिटवीन दे आर गेटिंग द जॉब एंड आफ्टर दैट दे कैन कंटिन्यू ऑल्सो. दिस इज द मेन, दिस इज वेरी गुड थिंग इन दिस. इफ यू टेक अ सब्जेक्ट ऑफ योर लाइक एंड यू गेट सम क्रेडिट्स इन दैट एंड आफ्टर दैट यू चेंज योर सब्जेक्ट, you can deposit those credits in the depository, and after completing your education again you can start that subject, and it can be planned very well that way. Student can choose as per their interest later on also.
Thank you. Ma'am, there is a question that what will be the role of the regulatory bodies and how, the regulatory bodies will help in implementation of the new education policy.
Regulatory bodies, they are changing their rules and regulations now, and hopefully HECI will come out, Higher Education Council of India, and AICTE and UGC, as we are seeing Delhi, they are going to merge and HECI will take over. Then hopefully granting power, granting of degrees, recognition of degrees, and granting the finance to the university will go to UGC, and the rest approval power and all that will go to AICTE, as we are hearing. We have not received anything in writing, but they are changing their regulation day by day, and emphasizing on online education also, which will be very helpful for the students, and they will get more powers. And as I said, except legal and medical, this thing all will, statutory body will be combined, and they will it will be better for the students to take any subject of their liking.
Ma'am, in continuation with what you just said, that online education will be also given, a prime importance. There is one more question, because that in the constantly changing world, the institutions and the curriculum and the teaching process has to become more dynamic, keeping with reference to the developments. This is not at all easy to manage, as some of the changes may not be known in advance. So, and also the use of technology and AI and machine learning tools, So, sir wanted to ask that while the new education policy mentions that the need there is a need to change and they are ready for change, but no, there is no much emphasis has been placed on how this will happen. So no, when we are almost, talking,
yes, almost all the institutions are interested in having this change actually. They want to change there, as we have switched over to smart classes now. Now we give lectures by video, audio, by both the methods also. So it's very difficult and very good thing to bring out these changes. And now we can show the videos of different teachers from abroad also, just to teach the students. It will be easy, and institutions are liking this now. They are going to adopt this. Day by day, they are using their own, I should say, learning management system and all that, just to have all these things from abroad and in India also.
Yes, absolutely, ma'am. I think that's right. There is another question that, ma'am, there are a lot of private institutions in India. So what is the future of these private institutions? What do you think?
If they will go by the rules of the government and they will do better, they maintain the quality. Very good institutions are there in private sector also. Very good deemed universities which are private and doing very good. Those are the examples for us, and they can work with public-private partnership also. Other universities also can work for that. And we should link with industry also for doing better. These private universities can do all these things in a better way, because they have money and they will get the grant from the government also for doing different professions this way. They can introduce many programs with the help of industry, and these private institutions are definitely doing better also than state universities.
Yes, ma'am, absolutely correct.
Because many state universities, they are not given grant, they don't have money to improve. This is the main problem with them.
Correct. Right, ma'am. Ma'am, there is another question that the move of new education policy is questionable because the education sector in our country is extremely underfunded. The condition of the government schools is deplorable and the lack of competence is starkly evident. What do you say on this?
It is not questionable. Now all the we are trying to do give education to in the rural areas also as per this new education policy, and students will learn, and they will be given skill education also, so that they can work after that, after doing their primary education also. Education for all is the main purpose of this education. And like I said, ki, gross enrollment ratio will be raised after adopting this policy. It will be from 24% to 50% in 2035 as per the new education policy.
Ma'am, I think the questions are this much. Ma'am, any concluding remarks from your side? What do you think, ma'am?
I will say this, ki we should adopt it. It's good policy, and wherever it is good, we can adopt good things, and whatever we can do better, we should do better also, and we should be for education and for good, better education, and we should maintain quality at least for the betterment. And I know your institution, our institution, I should say Geeta Ratan Institution, is doing very well, and you have A grade also. And I would like to visit also sometimes. So.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, there is one last question, ma'am. Ma'am, the institution of eminence are there in major cities, and new education policy is asking rural areas to be included.
Yeah, we are going to open
Yes.
like AIIMS, IITs in other states also, in rural areas also, so that students, it will be in the reach of the students to go there actually, to have the better education than they are getting now.
Yes, ma'am. I think definitely new education policy will change, you know, a lot of and bring a lot of new dimensions into this sector.
Hopefully, yes. Hopefully, yes.
Yes. Thank you so much, ma'am, for enlightening us with your words of wisdom. You've inspired all of us today. On behalf of Geeta Ratan International Business School, I would like to extend my gratitude towards your humble acceptance for joining us and enlightening everyone of us with your words of wisdom. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, everyone, for joining the session.
Thank you, madam. Thanks to all those who have patiently heard me.
And definitely every one of us has learned new dimensions of the education policy. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.